In accordance with Standing Order 43, the time for members' statements has concluded. The Prime Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I inform the House that the Minister for Industry, Innovation and Science will be absent from question time today for personal reasons, and the Minister for Defence Industry will answer questions on his behalf.
I thank the Prime Minister. Questions without notice. The member for Isaacs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. I refer to the Senate inquiry into the legal services direction issued by the Attorney-General. Can the Prime Minister confirm the Senate inquiry found, and I quote, "the lack of respect that the Attorney-General has displayed towards the Solicitor-General and the state of their relationship prior to the Solicitor-General's resignation demonstrates his lack of competence to hold the office of Attorney-General"? Does the Prime Minister still support the direction that was issued by the Attorney-General?
The Minister for Justice and the Leader of the House will cease interjecting. The Prime Minister has the call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Over the years, I think we've all learned that the honourable and distinguished senior counsel opposite does not hold his counterpart, the Attorney-General, in the highest of regard. Over the years, I've picked up that barristers often have reservations about the talents of each other. Mr. Speaker, the Attorney-General has my full confidence. The committee, as you know, the majority report, was written by his political opponents and should be viewed in that light.
The member for Hughes.
Question is to the Prime Minister. Will the Prime Minister update the House on the importance of new policies to secure Australia's border and the consequence of alternate policies?
Just before I call the Prime Minister, at this point yesterday in question time, I made it very clear the level of noise was far too high. It's already too high before the Prime Minister's been able to utter a word in response to the question. It's unsatisfactory. I'm not going to issue repeated warnings. I want to make it as clear as I can to members who are interjecting that they will need to be dealt with. The parliament cannot operate with this level of disruption, and it is not what the public have come to see. The Prime Minister has the call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The member for Gellibrand will leave under 94A.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The reaction from the opposition benches is entirely consistent with the complacency their party showed when they were in government in 2008, and 9, and 10, and 11, and 12, when, ignoring all of the evidence, all of the experience, they unpicked John Howard's tough and effective border protection policies, and as a result, as a direct consequence, we saw 50,000 unauthorised arrivals, the opening of 17 new detention centres in Australia, an immigration blowout in cost of $11 billion, 8,000 children put into detention, the reopening of regional processing centres in Nauru and Manus, and most tragically of all, Mr. Speaker, 1,200 deaths at sea, of which we know. And the Labor Party then, when Kevin Rudd returned, claimed that they'd learnt their lesson. And they said then that they would be on a unity ticket with the coalition. And they said, and Kevin Rudd said, and honourable members opposite, many of them echoed his words. The member for Isaacs, in fact, did. The member for Watson did. And they said, nobody who seeks to come to Australia by boat shall ever be able to settle in Australia. And they said that in 2013. And that has been the position they have taken since then, or they claim to have taken since then. Now, the reality is, Mr. Speaker, it was the coalition that stopped the boats. It was the coalition government's determination to stop the boats to ensure that our borders were secure. And we know, Mr. Speaker, how serious a threat irregular migration is. The Foreign Minister spoke yesterday of John Kerry saying it was viewed in Europe as an existential threat. When I was at the United Nations only a few weeks ago, one leader after another from Europe talk to me about the extraordinary threat they face from irregular migration, what it does to promote intolerance, what it does to undermine a civil discourse, what it does to undermine their union. Maintaining our border is absolutely essential. So when we brought in this legislation before the House this week, we asked the Labor Party to do no more than prove again that they are on that unity ticket, to do no more than send with us the strongest, most unequivocal message to the people smugglers that you will not succeed, and they have failed us, they failed Australia, they failed the integrity of our borders.
The Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you. My question is to the Prime Minister. On the 19th of October, the Prime Minister defended the Attorney-General's 37 new appointments to the AAT, saying, and I quote, "I have no doubt that all the persons appointed were excellently qualified." Given there was no merits-based selection process, no advice from the department, no advertising of positions, simply handpicked by the Attorney-General, what exactly were the excellent qualifications that justified these people receiving jobs paying up to $370,000 a year?
The Prime Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I'm glad that the honourable member is interested in the appointment of those individuals. I'll take the question on notice and make sure he receives an answer in respect of their respective qualifications.
The member for Durack.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister for Immigration and Border Protection. Will the Minister update the House on steps the government is taking to further bolster Australia's robust border protection measures? Is the Minister aware of any alternative approaches?
The Minister for Immigration and Border Protection.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the honourable member for her question. This is a very important issue because, as people know, the Australian public has watched this issue for a long, long period of time. And the Australian public wants in their Prime Minister, wants in their government, people that have the ability to stare down the threats that we face on the national security front, and people want us to have strong and secure borders. They want us to bring people to our country that deserve a new start in life, and this government provides a record number each year of places under the refugee and humanitarian program, and we will continue to do that. But the Australian public will not support that program if we allow the people smugglers to get back into business. Now, the people smugglers in Indonesia and across the rest of Southeast Asia and indeed across the world, of course, have not gone away. This Leader of the Opposition wanted people at the beginning of this week to believe that somehow the problem of people smuggling had disappeared, that it had evaporated, and that there was no problem, that there was no ongoing problem, that somehow the 14,000 people in Indonesia who are waiting to get onto boats today, somehow mystically they've disappeared, somehow the tragedy that we see on the Mediterranean or people who are moving through Europe or coming from Africa, that somehow that problem has dissolved. I mean, this is a Leader of the Opposition that is completely out of step with the Australian people, and yet he went to the last election saying that he would provide a unity ticket with the coalition adopting the successful policies that we have been presiding over for the last 3 years, which has stopped the boats. Now, it is true, Mr. Speaker, that the government this week has introduced legislation which will provide a further strengthening of our borders. It is absolutely apparent to all concerned that this is necessary legislation, and yet this is a problem that is with us now, that we are addressing now, and that will not go away. And yet the only advice offered by the Leader of the Opposition as to why he would not support this bill, which is designed at staring down people smugglers, is because he's worried about people in 40 years' time applying for a tourist visa to come to our country. Now, I don't know what his prediction is, and I don't want this to come as a shock, as a big shock to the markets or to the Australian people, but there probably will be a Labor government within the next 4 decades. It won't be good for the economy, it won't be good for unemployment, it certainly won't be good for border protection. But if the Labor Party believes at the 20 or 30-year mark they want to abolish this legislation, they can do it. But let me make this prediction, Mr. Speaker. This Leader of the Opposition, just as he went to the last election, will go to the next election asking the Australian public to trust him on border protection. But every day that goes by, The Australian public is reminded again that the people smugglers won Lotto twice with Rudd and Gillard, but they have struck a jackpot a third time around with this Leader of the Opposition, who is the weakest Labor leader when it comes to border protection.
Members on my left and right, just before I call the next question, I'd like to inform the House that we have present in the chamber this afternoon Her Excellency Menna Rawlings, the British High Commissioner, and Mr Alec Sharma, Member for Reading West in the United Kingdom. On behalf of the House, I extend a very warm welcome to you both. And could I also welcome the New Zealand High Commissioner, His Excellency Mr Chris Seed, who's here as well. Welcome to you all. The Member for Isaacs.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. I refer to the Prime Minister's previous answer. Is the Prime Minister aware that the Attorney-General's 37 new appointments to the Administrative Appeals Tribunal included Liberal donors, former Liberal MPs, failed Liberal candidates and Liberal Party operatives such as Theo Tavularis, Saxton Rice, John Sosso, Nicholas McGowan
and Bruce McCarthy?
The Member for Isaacs
will resume his seat. The Minister for Immigration will cease interjecting. The Leader of the House will cease interjecting. I'm trying to listen to the question, which members expect me to rule on. The Member for Melbourne Ports is warned. The Member for Isaacs will begin his question from the start and the clock will be reset.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. I refer to the Prime Minister's previous answer. Is the Prime Minister aware that the Attorney-General's 37 new appointments to the Administrative Appeals Tribunal included Liberal donors, former Liberal MPs, failed Liberal candidates and Liberal Party operatives such as Theo Tavularis, Saxon Rice, John Sosso, Nicholas McGowan and Bruce McCarthy? Is this what the Prime Minister meant when he referred to excellent qualifications?
The Prime Minister has the call.
Well, thank you.
The Minister for Immigration.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. And it is typical, I may say, of the Member for Isaacs that he seeks to defame people by smear and innuendo. He has no substantive matter. He has no substantive matter to question any of these people. If he does, he should raise it. The Leader of the Opposition has asked about their qualifications. Those can be provided by the attorney in due course. But Mr Speaker, what about an appointment that was fundamentally more momentous than an appointment to the Administrative Appeals Tribunal? What about the Leader of the Opposition's hand-picked member of the Senate, Kimberley Kitching? What did the Leader of the Opposition
Members on my
satisfy
right.
himself that, contrary to the finding of the Hayden Royal Commission, she was truthful in her evidence? What did the Leader of the Opposition do to satisfy himself that the Royal Commission had no basis for referring her conduct to the Director of Public Prosecution for investigation, consideration for bringing criminal charges against her?
The Member for Kimberley Kitching and the Leader of the House.
Kimberley Kitching's conduct has been the subject of findings of a Royal Commission presided over by a retired High Court judge. It has been the subject of findings by the Fair Work Commission, and the fact of the matter is that the Leader of the Opposition, despite many opportunities, has not had the guts to stand up and say Kimberley Kitching is qualified to be in the Senate and the findings
Prime
of the Hayden Royal Commission were wrong, and this
seat.
Is why they are wrong.
The Prime Minister will resume his seat for a second. Has the Prime Minister concluded his answer? The Prime Minister has concluded his answer. Just before I call the member for Melbourne, we have a number of distinguished visitors with us today. And I'd also like to welcome the Premier of South Australia, the Honourable Jay Weatherill, to the House today. Also former Senator, the Honourable Helen Coonan, who's with us today, and former member Peter Lindsay and former Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister for Defence. On behalf of the House, I extend a warm welcome to all of you. The Member for Melbourne.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. Since the election, you've attacked renewable energy and defended coal. You've proposed permanent bans on refugees coming to Australia seeking our help, and now you're caving into Senator Pauline Hanson and the Donald Trumps in your party on race hate laws. Will you rule out allowing Donald Trump-style hate speech to flourish in Australia by changing the law to make it easier to say racist things? Or are you now so beholden to the far right that you're letting Pauline Hanson write your policy? Prime Minister, do you actually believe in this Trump-style agenda, or are you just content with being the poor man's Tony Abbott?
The Prime Minister will resume his seat. The Prime Minister will resume his seat. I've cautioned many members on referring to members by their correct title. The member for Hughes will leave under 94A. I've cautioned many members on this, and I've made it clear I'm not going to keep cautioning them continuously. The member for Gellibrand learnt this in the 92nd statements. Pity he's not here to hear it now. Members will refer to members by their correct titles. I'm not allowing an opportunity to rephrase the question. I'm moving to the next question. No, I've made a ruling. You did not refer to the member for Warringah by his correct title. I've made it very clear. I'm not going to keep repeating this day by day. The member for Melbourne will resume his seat. The member for Banks has the call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. Will the Prime Minister advise the House on the dangers of trivialising border security and the ongoing need to send clear signals to people smugglers that their trade will never be tolerated?
The Prime Minister will just pause for a second, won't resume his seat or be getting a lot of exercise. The member for Bruce will leave under 94A. The Prime Minister has the call.
Mr. Speaker, I thank the honourable member for his question. Mr. Speaker, as the honourable member understands very well, our nation, the most successful multicultural nation in the world, is built on a foundation of mutual respect, on a foundation where Australians understand that it is their government which determines who comes to Australia. It is their government which determines which refugees come to Australia. It is their government which determines the integrity of their borders. Now, Mr. Speaker, in the world today we face a scourge of people smuggling. These are multi-billion dollar criminal organisations. They are operating globally. They are a threat to democracies. They're a threat to the political integrity of many countries. They are a threat to our multicultural harmony.
The member for Cowan.
Mr. Speaker, we take this threat seriously. We understand that the people smugglers need the clearest
The member for
Cowan
will leave under 94A.
They need a message which says unequivocally, you will not be able to get your passengers to Australia. Full stop. You will not succeed. That is what enables us to have one of the most generous humanitarian programs in the world. That is what has enabled us to take 12,000 refugees in addition to our annual quota from the conflict zone. But what have we heard from the Labor Party this week? They have scoffed and trivialised border security. The Leader of the Opposition yesterday said we're not on a unity ticket to stop the tourists. So are the people smugglers tourist operators? Is that what the Labor Party believes? Are they just tourists? Is this the way in which the Labor Party treats national security? We have seen this complacency before. This is precisely the scoffing, the sneering, the patronising complacency of the Labor Party was in evidence some years ago under Kevin Rudd, when he mocked members of the Liberal Party and the National Party when we challenged him for his neglect of our border security. And the consequence was the tragedy that followed. 50,000 unauthorised arrivals, 1,200 deaths at sea, of which we know, and more misery, people put into Nauru and Manus that we have been endeavouring to resettle. No thanks, no help from the Labor Party that put them there. Mr. Speaker, it's time the Labor Party took border security seriously. It's time they owned up to their responsibilities as an alternative government and stood up for Australia and the integrity of our borders.
The member for Sydney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. Yesterday, the minister representing the Minister for Education said that the $1.84 million grant to a college linked to former Senator Day, and I quote, went through all the normal processes. Can the Prime Minister outline what these normal processes were?
The Minister representing the Minister for Education.
Mr. Speaker, I thank the member for Sydney for her question. And the point that the member for Sydney is making is completely erroneous. And the facts of what she has said, do not bear with the actual issues that Senator Birmingham has been dealing with in vocational education and training. The program about which the member for Sydney has been asking questions did not exist when Senator Birmingham met with and visited the North East Vocational Education College referred to by the member for Sydney. It did not actually exist. So, in which case, the claims that she's been trying to make against Senator Birmingham are not made out. So the premise of the question is quite false. When the North East Vocational Education College applied for the grants through the normal processes, the financial viability tests were carried out correctly by the department and their obligations were fulfilled. And Senator Day had absolutely no financial involvement with the North East Vocational Education College.
The Minister will resume his seat. The Minister has completed his answer? The Minister's completed his answer. The member for Mallee.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister for Agriculture and Water Resources. Is the Deputy Prime Minister aware of any proposals that would treat foreign agricultural workers better than Australian agricultural workers? What impact would such an outcome have on young job seekers in regional Australia?
The member for Deakin will cease interjecting. The member for Hunter. The Deputy Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I thank the honourable member for his question, and yes, I do know of an alternate policy that is going to discriminate against Australian workers for foreign workers. And I note also that this is in the backpacker tax issue. We had negotiated with so many people, an outcome that was both fair and also attract labour from overseas, an outcome that was backed by the NFF, which said, and I quote, at the rate of 19%, Australian wages are competitive with New Zealand and Canada, and we can start to reconnect with working holiday makers, an outcome that was supported by New South Wales farmers, which were happy on the proposed 19% rate, an outcome that was supported by the Northern Territory Farmers Association, which had confidence in the new rate, an outcome that was supported by QFF, an outcome that was supported by the VFF, an outcome that was supported by the Lockyer fruit growers, an outcome that was supported by so many. But now we have this strange amalgam where we have the Senator Jackie Lambie, Bill Shorten, One Nation Pact with
The Deputy Prime Minister will refer to members by their correct titles. I'm addressing the House. When I've concluded addressing the House, I'll hear the Manager of Opposition Business. I've made it very clear that members need to be referred to by their correct titles. I've made it very clear with the member for Melbourne, and I've not allowed him to ask his question. You got one right and the other wrong, okay? And you didn't, you know, the question I've ruled out of order, I've repeatedly asked this, I'm clamping down on it, and I know it's hard, but that's where I'm going to leave it, and I'm going to leave the Deputy Prime Minister at that point and go to the next question. The member for Sydney. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is again to the Prime Minister. I refer to the previous answer from the Minister in relation to the $1.84 million grant to a college link to former Senator Day. Given that this $1.84 million grant was almost $500,000 more than was requested by the college, It was awarded without any open procurement process, and it was informed by a report co-authored by Liberal Party politicians. Is this really normal process for your government?
The Minister for Education representing them.
It is remarkable, Mr. Speaker, to be lectured by the Labor Party on fiscal rectitude. This is the Labor Party who were responsible
members
for the home insulation program, colloquially called the Pink Bats program, which was responsible for killing people.
The member for
Sydney was responsible for people's deaths.
Ejecting.
The home insulation program was responsible for the deaths of young Australians put into danger in the ceilings of homes in Australia because of the Labor Party's Pink Bats program. And this party dares to lecture us about the delivery of programs. You should hang your heads in shame. You should be embarrassed to come into this house and ask us that are fixing up the mess of the 6 years of the Gillard-Rudd government to ask us about questions to do with
the
fiscal
rectitude. The Minister will
resume
his seat. The member for Lilly used an unparliamentary term that I heard clearly. He will withdraw.
I will not withdraw, Mr. Speaker.
I will not
be lectured to by
the
that
member
minister
for Lilly
in that
will
way.
Leave under 94A. The Minister for Immigration will be following if he interjects on the member for Lilly. The member for Sydney on a point of order.
Well, it's a point of order on relevance. It would be great if the minister began to address the process that was gone through to award this grant.
I've been listening to the minister. The minister is in order. If the member for Sydney wishes to argue with me, she won't be in the chamber. I'm not going to debate these points of order endlessly. I will hear them, I will rule, and we'll move on. And I remind the member for Sydney, she's already been warned and there's been a general warning issued. The minister representing the Minister for Education.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And of course, I was commenting on the delivery of programs about which I was asked and proper processes. And as the Shadow Minister for Education during the Rudd government, I saw firsthand how the school hall program was rolled out by the then minister, Julia Gillard. A $16 billion program. A $16 billion program where school halls were built next door to other school halls, where school halls in country towns were built next to town halls that had been used for over 100 years for school assemblies, money pushed out the door. Now, to respond specifically to the member for Sydney's question, the North East Vocational College received exactly the same grant, exactly the same grant as the four other colleges in the pilot program. Exactly the same grant. The minister, Senator Birmingham, did exactly what was required of him in his responsibilities. The department fulfilled their responsibilities, and therefore the members' questions. Is the premise of the member's question is false, Mr. Speaker.
The member for Barker. Yeah.
My question is to the Treasurer. Will the Treasurer update the House on the importance of developing policies that return the budget to balance and grow the economy? How is the government reducing the tax burden on hard-working Australians to improve their standards of living, secure their jobs, make it easier to find employment and save for their retirement?
The Treasurer has a call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for Barker for his question. In the budget, as he knows, in the budget we announced tax cuts for wage earners, and they have passed this parliament already, Mr. Speaker. We announced tax cuts for small businesses to extend the definition of a small business from $2 million to $10 million, which would benefit 2.2 million Australians working in 100,000 companies. That's being opposed by those opposite, Mr. Speaker. In the budget, we announced new superannuation tax concessions for working Australians who earn up to 90% of their income from non-wage sources like running a business. That is opposed by those opposite, Mr. Speaker. In addition, we propose in the budget new super concessions for women and carers returning to the workforce to be able to catch up on their superannuation with new concessions. That is opposed, Mr. Speaker, by those opposite. Instead, those opposite, Mr. Speaker, have another proposal. They think all of that shouldn't be happening. Small business should be paying more tax. Those who are earning an income through a business should not get access to superannuation concessions. But by alternative, they believe that foreign workers in this country should be given a tax cut. That is the proposal put by those opposite, which will cost the budget $500 million, Mr. Speaker. Those opposite are proposing a tax cut for foreign workers, while at the same time saying small business owners, people working for small businesses, should be paying more tax. Now, today, Mr. Speaker, I read a transcript of someone who I thought would be supporting the Coalition's position of ensuring that Australian jobs would come first. He said this: "We've got a big issue when you have people who come here on 417 visas. These are visas. This is the backpacker visa, Mr. Speaker. These are visas which give people from overseas temporary work rights in Australia. Yet we've got auto electricians and mechanics and carpenters who can't get work in Australia. The government should be prioritising Australian jobs." That's what the Leader of the Opposition said on the 9th of November today, Mr. Speaker. And what he's suggesting to help Australian workers is we should be giving foreign workers a tax cut. And not just a tax cut, but a tax cut that is unfunded and they want to hit Australian taxpayers for, with $500 million hit to the budget. They want to reduce the savings of Australians. They want to hold on to higher tax rates for small businesses, but when it comes to foreign workers, Mr. Speaker, they want to give them a big, fat tax cut, Mr. Speaker. What a bunch of hypocrites, Mr. Speaker. What a bunch of hypocrites, because at the end of the day, on this side, we'll deliver real tax cuts for Australian workers.
The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Prime Minister. Did the Northwest College, linked to Bob Day, receive the amount they asked for, or did the government give this organisation, linked to Bob Day, more than they actually asked for? And is this normal process for this government to provide organisations more money than they asked for?
The members on my left, the Leader of the House on a point of order.
I was actually going to answer the question, Mr. Speaker.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry, it's the way you approached the dispatch box.
I'm happy to take a point of order if you prefer, the minister
for Education.
Apart from the fact, Mr. Speaker, that the college is called the Northeast Vocational College as opposed to Northwest, but I'm prepared to overlook just yet another sloppy bit of work by the man of opposition business on behalf of his leader, Mr. Speaker, for which I would have been sacked when I was the man of opposition business. I can tell you. Under the current member for Warringah, he would never have put up with me making such a fundamental error, Mr. Speaker. But let's pretend that the question was correct, Mr. Speaker. The simple facts are, being lectured by the Labor Party on these matters shows a great audacity. Now, the Leader of the Opposition has shown a preparedness to tell the great big Labor lie for most of his political career, and in fact, the Medi-Scare campaign really took the cake. But now, rather than focusing on the issues that mum and dads care about in Australia, things like energy prices, things like energy security, things about their incomes through social security or tax cuts, or how they're going to pay their mortgages on their homes, or housing affordability, or in fact even national security issues like what's going on at the moment in Mosul and Raqqa and elsewhere in the world. Rather than focusing on those issues, the Labor Party is trying to blacken the name of former Senator Bob Day. Former Senator Bob Day. And cast aspersions on the qualifications of senators, Mr. Speaker. Now, it shows a particular audacity for the member for Maribyrnong, the Leader of the Opposition, to wade into the issue of who should or shouldn't be in the Senate, Mr. Speaker, because we all know that he has amongst his number Senator Kimberley Kitchen sitting in the Senate representing Victoria right now.
The Leader of the House will resume his seat. the Deputy Prime Minister will cease interjecting, and the Manager of Opposition business on a point of order.
Thanks, Mr. Speaker. On direct relevance, the question went specifically to whether or not the amount given was more than the amount which had been requested.
I've listened to the point of order. I'm listening very carefully to the Minister representing the Minister for Education's answer. And as he well knows, being the Leader of the House, he has some ability to compare and contrast, but that can't be all of the remainder of his answer.
I think the Manager of Opposition Business makes a reasonable point, Mr. Speaker. I'm surprised I got that far. But nevertheless, I'll come back to Senator Kitching later in question time, because there's quite a lot people want to know about Senator Kitching in the House of Representatives and in the general public, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the reality is that the North East Vocational College received exactly the same grant as every other college in the pilot program. And I hear the member for Sydney interjecting about this issue.
Well, none of us should be hearing the member for Sydney.
Quite right, Mr. Speaker. And it pains
if
me
hear
to
the
say
member for Sydney interjecting again, it'll be the last.
The ruck, Mr. Speaker. This is the member who, when she was the Minister for Health, Mr. Speaker, was responsible for the National Housing Affordability Scheme, NHAS, upon which hundreds of millions of dollars were spent to build housing for international students. The biggest group that accessed the National Housing Affordability Scheme, which was a scheme for the homeless, which was a scheme designed for low-income and homeless Australians, the largest accessor
the
of it was international student
time
accommodation.
Has expired. Just before I call the member for Flynn, could I inform the House that we have present in the chamber this afternoon the 24th APEC delegation from the People's Republic of China, led by Ms. Wang Ting. On behalf of the House, we extend you a very warm welcome. The member for Flynn.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Small Business. Will the Minister inform the House why the implementation of the government's workers' holiday making reform package is important for the Australian small businesses, including those in the seat of Flynn?
The Minister for Small Business.
Mr. Speaker, I thank the member for Flynn for his question, and he understands as many as most, as much as most, about small business, because he ran petroleum companies, pubs. He ran hardware stores, and in his electorate of Flynn, it makes an enormous contribution to the growth of the Australian economy, Mr. Speaker, through the cultivation of sugarcane, fruits, nuts and grain. He knows that backpackers support the farmers and the producers in his electorate. That's why he's so passionately fought for a fair, for a just outcome. Our working holiday maker reform package proposes a reduction in the tax rate from 32.5% to 19%. It ensures backpackers will pay a fair amount of tax on their earnings and is internationally competitive. Now, the impact of the Turnbull-Joyce government's reform package is financially neutral. It's fully offset within the budget. Labor refuses to seek costings for its very irresponsible proposal. Its irresponsible proposal. Labor, Mr. Speaker, does not understand regional Australia. It neither cares nor knows about regional Australia. It's playing politics. It's backed down on its election commitment. Nothing new there. Nothing new there, Mr. Speaker. It fails to recognise that backpackers make an important contribution to Australia's $43.4 billion tourism industry and are a key source of labour, particularly in regional Australia. Farmers are being used as political fodder, which should come as no surprise from a Labor Party which, in government, Mr. Speaker, cut funding to our regions, stood in the way of dam construction and attempted to ruin our live cattle industry. Labor's proposal to reduce the backpacker tax rate to 10.5% completely ignores the solid support that the government has received from the National Farmers Federation, no less. What we're seeing from the Labor Party is an absolute slap in the face, an absolute slap in the face to many of the regional and small businesses who are farmers, the local publicans, the cafe owners, the tourism operators, who rely on seasonal workforces
and backpacker labour. It's an affront to Australian workers. It's an affront to Australian workers. At least we're sticking up for Australian workers on this side of the House. What would Labor like to see, Mr Speaker? Fruit rotting on the ground? A pub with no cheer? We all know that backpackers who earn their money in regional Australia, we all know they often then travel the countryside, experience what this great land has to offer, further contributing to our economy whilst experiencing all the tourism, all the wonderful things that Australia has to offer. Now, the stalling of the passage of legislation for this means that backpackers will be liable for the 32.5% tax rate from New Year's Day, creating uncertainty, creating instability for the agriculture, horticulture, tourism and hospitality sectors. Labor has no understanding, Mr Speaker. No plan for Australian small businesses. Just want to sit there as idle puppets to their union mates.
The Minister's time has expired. The Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister has praised the action taken by his Special Minister of State in August 2016 to investigate Bob Day's eligibility to sit in the Senate. Given that the Special Minister relied upon the same information that his Minister for Finance had back in February 2016, why didn't the Minister for Finance take the same action back then that the Minister for State took in August 2016?
The Prime Minister.
The Leader of the Opposition for his question, Mr Speaker, and note, as I did yesterday and I think the day before, that the Minister for Finance has set out all of the circumstances, the reason for the actions that he took in his comprehensive speech to the Senate, and I refer the honourable member to it.
The member for Fisher.
My question is to the Minister for Defence Industry, representing the Minister for Employment. Will the minister outline why registered organisations need to be regulated to ensure that employer and employee organisations always act in the best interests of their members, and who stands to benefit from these reforms? Who is standing in the way of this outcome?
The Minister for Defence Industry.
Well, thank you, Mr Speaker, and I thank the member for Fisher for this question. It's a much better question than the ones I've been receiving from the member for Sydney and the Leader of the Opposition. It goes to an issue that Australians very much care about, and that is how to make sure we have honest unions and honest union leaders. And for that reason, the government has introduced the Registered Organisations Commission Bill, has taken it to an election and won that election on a double dissolution trigger, giving us the mandate that we require for the Registered Organisations Commission Bill to be passed. And the Registered Organisations Commission Bill, Mr Speaker, will help to achieve honest unions and honest union leaders. And it's very much in Labor's interest. I'm asked who will benefit, Mr Speaker, by the member for Fisher. It is very much in Labor's interest to clean up the union movement, because they are connected as if by an umbilical cord to the union movement. And so the government is trying to assist the Labor Party to be connected to a union movement that is honest rather than a union movement that is dishonest, Mr Speaker. We've seen the latest evidence of this recently in the appointment of Senator Kitching to the Senate by the Leader of the Opposition, Mr Speaker, over the very strenuous objections of many of his current front bench and the Victorian Labor Party, including, as I understand it, the Shadow Attorney-General. This is actually a very serious issue, though, Mr Speaker, for the Leader of the Opposition, and we certainly had some fun talking about Senator Kitching's failure to pay things like her parking fines, but it is a very important issue because, quite frankly, Mr Speaker, what did the Leader of the Opposition do to satisfy himself that Senator Kitching had the qualifications necessary to sit in the Senate? And what did he do to satisfy himself that the reference by the Trade Union Royal Commission to the Commonwealth DPP of Senator Kitching impersonating union leaders, six union leaders, was to be dismissed, had no foundation? And secondly, Mr Speaker, what did the Leader of the Opposition do to assure himself that Senator Kitching has not perjured herself in the Trade Union Royal Commission? Because in the event that the Commonwealth DPP convicts Senator Kitching of the reference being sent to them by the Trade Union Royal Commission, that will be proof positive that she perjured herself in the Trade Union Royal Commission. And Mr Speaker, there are six witnesses who appeared in the Trade Union Royal Commission, witnesses Lee, Govan, McCubbin, Porter, Morrie and Leshinsky, who all contradicted
Senator Kitching. Six Labor figures from the union that she was a member of have contradicted Senator Kitching in the Trade Union Royal Commission, some in a way that would put themselves in danger. So, Mr. Speaker, what advice did the Leader of the Opposition seek from the member for Isaacs, the Shadow Attorney-General, about the qualifications of Senator Kitching and whether it was appropriate for her to be appointed to the Senate, Mr. Speaker? Because I think we'll find
the
that he did seek advice and he received
expired.
It.
If anyone knows any further details, member for Deakin. Member for McMahon.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Treasurer. It's been revealed today that the New South Wales Liberal government has lobbied credit ratings agencies to defend their AAA rating in anticipation of the Commonwealth losing its AAA credit rating. Is the Turnbull government so chaotic and incompetent that even Mike Baird has lost confidence in this Treasurer's ability to defend Australia's AAA rating?
The Treasurer has the call.
Mr. Speaker, thank you for the call and I thank the member for his question. Mr. Speaker, at the last election, those opposite thought the way to retain the AAA credit rating of this country was to increase the deficit of the country by $16.5 billion. That's what they proposed at the last election. But after their latest incursion into this area, we know that that deficit would be even higher because we know, Mr. Speaker, that members opposite want to actually not fund a tax cut for foreign workers, which will actually cost the budget another $500 million, Mr. Speaker. And they all somehow think that this is actually going to improve the financial position of this country. And Mr. Speaker, the member for Hunter, earlier today, or yesterday I think it was, talked about what the impact of the tax cut for foreign workers will be on the budget, and he basically said, well, it just means we'll have less money and we'll just have to deal with that. And that is the approach of those opposite, like the member for Jagga Jagga when she used to talk about, well, how will we find the money to deal with childcare? Oh, we'll find it somewhere. It'll turn up somewhere or somehow over the rainbow, Mr. Speaker. That is the approach of those opposite. What those opposite do when they sit on these benches is they carelessly engage in reckless spending, drive up taxes, drive up debt, drive up a deficit, Mr. Speaker. And as a result, they have placed the nation's finances in the position that we inherited as a government. Now, Mr. Speaker, we have had $40 billion of budget improvement measures that we put to the last election. $40 billion of budget improvement measures we put to the last election. More than a quarter of those have already been passed through this parliament, but the rest have to pass, Mr. Speaker. The rest have to pass to ensure that we can put Australia in the strongest possible position when it comes to the assessment by external agencies of our financial position. But those opposite don't support those measures, Mr. Speaker. They don't. They don't support those measures. What they want to do is drive up the deficit and drive up the debt and somehow think that is an answer to this nation's economic challenges and in returning the budget to surplus. So I would ask those opposite to reflect on the question they just asked. And if they want to protect Australia's credit rating, then they should take the advice of Standard & Poor's, who have said quite plainly that the government's fiscal trajectory, our fiscal trajectory to return the budget to surplus, requires the support of this parliament in this chamber and the other chamber. So if you're concerned about the credit rating, pass our savings, pass our revenue measures and just allow us to get on with the job of achieving what you failed to do.
The member for Swan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister for Trade, Tourism and Investment. Will the minister explain how the development at Perth Airport will support Australia's tourism industry and create jobs and economic growth for Western Australia? How is the government supporting this project, and is the minister aware of impediments for its progress?
The Minister for Trade and Investment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'm very pleased to get the question from the member for Swan. I know the member for Swan has been a great advocate for infrastructure in his electorate, including the Grand Gateway near Perth Airport.
It is indeed a great vision,
and it's great to have his advocacy for it. Western Australia welcomed some 888,000 international visitors in the last year, which represents an increase of some 19% over the past 3 years. Now, this is on top of the 9.2 million domestic visitors who travelled to WA, which represents an increase of some 40% since 2013. So great news for the tourism industry in Western Australia, but particularly for Perth Airport. And I know the member for Swan was at the official opening of the new airport terminal that was opened by the member for Stirling, and he's congratulated Perth Airport on this development in the House. And, Mr Speaker, this is just the beginning of developments and investment in tourism at Perth Airport. The current vision for the airport is a world-class airport experience operating from one precinct, Airport Central, that will offer terminal and passenger facilities for some 40 million passengers a year and beyond. On top of this, the CEO of the Qantas Group, Alan Joyce, has confirmed that the airline is looking seriously at a Perth to London direct flight once the airline receives the new 787 Dreamliner. So great news for employment and tourism in Australia's west coast. But I note that the member also asks about any impediments to the development of Perth Airport. And I bring to the attention of the House an article from the Australian newspaper earlier this year that had the headline, CFMEU officials fined over Perth Airport project blockade. And the article said, the federal court found senior officials from the Construction, Forestry, Mining and Energy Union have a cavalier attitude to complying with industrial laws as it handed out $21,000 of fines over a blockade at the $80 million Perth Airport expansion project. And in a judgment, the justice found that the CFMEU arranged for about 100 protesters to blockade the airport project in 2013. Now, does Labor ever say anything against the CFMEU on this? Do you ever hear from the Shadow Tourism Minister about the militant and extreme CFMEU? You never hear a peep. And the reason you never hear from them, Mr Speaker, the reason Labor never says anything about the CFMEU, the reason the Labor Party is silent about the direct links between the Labor Party and bikies, between the Labor Party, the CFMEU and indeed organised crime, the reason you never hear about complaints from the Labor Party is because he's
Minister
got 11 million...
Seat. The Minister will resume his seat. I'm going to hear the Leader of the Opposition on a point of order, and I suspect...
The old Minister for Tourism overstepped the mark.
Hang on. I haven't called the Leader of the Opposition yet. There won't be a debate about this across the Minister and the Leader of the Opposition. The interjections, again, the member for Deakin will leave under 94A. The interjections prevented me from hearing everything that the minister was saying. I'm going to call the Leader of the Opposition on a point of order.
Tourism, the Minister for Tourism knew what he was doing. He made an absolutely inappropriate impugning of Labor, and he should get up and withdraw his most unparliamentary remark.
If the minister, I hate to say, if the minister impugned a particular individual, the practice and the standing orders will be very clear on that. However, when it comes to a political party, it's quite a different matter, no matter how difficult or offensive that is. Whoever interjected from the right will be out if I... So I have to say to the Leader of the Opposition, when it's quite a different matter. There's been ruled very strongly when the character of the Leader of the Opposition individually has been impugned, but when it comes to a political party, that is a different matter. I'm going to keep listening to the minister. Warn him he's on thin ice.
Thank you very much, Mr Speaker. But if the Labor Party don't like the links between the CFMEU and bikies, if they don't like the links with the militant and extreme CFMEU, they should do something about it, not take $11 million to look the other way, because the fact is this is why we need a tough cop on the beat.
Has expired. Members on my right, the Treasurer, the member for Hunter.
Mr Speaker, my question is to the Minister for Agriculture. Minister, speaking about Donald Trump this morning, you said, and I'll try to quote accurately, what people say on the campaign trail is mitigated by the strong advice they get once they get into office, because if you just fly solo on every issue, you will create major problems for your nation. Minister, has this been your experience with your own handling of the backpacker tax, drought relief and the relocation of the Pesticides Authority to your own electorate, just to name a few.
The Deputy Prime Minister has the call.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I have to say with all earnestness, I thank the member for his question. And you know, the last time he asked me a question, the 9th of November last year, he is the political Santa Claus of this place. He comes to the dispatch box, but once a year, but once a year. But it's great to see you here, and it's great to see that you still have not really been able to ask me a question exclusively about agriculture. And I think that it's very important, if you look at the current polling, to be a little bit careful about what you say about what might be the next president of the United States, noting that Mr. Trump is currently ahead and way ahead on the odds of winning the presidential race. Now, what I do note is that I think the reason that the member for Hunter comes to the dispatch box but once a year is because when he does actually open his mouth, he creates a catastrophe. And he did one the other day with his announcement of a new rate for overseas workers at the expense of Australian workers, a new rate of tax at 10.5% for overseas workers, for backpackers, which, let's look at this. I thought that the Labor Party was the party of workers. They were the party that used to stand up for workers. And might we go to a shed at Bawarrina, where on stand number one is an AWU ticket holder who is shearing sheep for $3.08 a head. $3.08 a head, and his take-home pay, because their average gets around about $55,000 a year. So at that rate, they'll take home about $2.08. But the sharer next door to them on stand number two, a backpacker from Uruguay, is taking home $2.75. And who came up with this brain explosion? Well, of course, it was the member for Hunter in cahoots with Senator Jackie Lambie, the Senator Jackie Lambie running economic policy for the Labor Party. What an incredible day. What an incredible day. How do you stand up for Australian workers when you are giving a distinct advantage to overseas workers? Is this the same attitude you used when you stood up for the workers at Clean Event? Is this the same attitude you used when you stood up for the workers at Chiquita Mushrooms? So who are you hurting now? Well, none other but the whole of the Australian workforce. This is a party that says they believe in Australian jobs, yet this is a party that yesterday created the mechanism for the preference of overseas workers over Australian workers, over Australian workers. And why? Why? And now who else are they trying to get close to? Well, they're trying to get close to One Nation. They're trying to get One Nation, Senator Jackie Lambie, led by the member for Hunter. What an absolute work of genius. What an absolute work of genius. I tell you what you should do. Don't let him down the chimney once a year. Just stick him back up the chimney and let's never see him again.
The member for Macmillan.
Well, thank you for the call, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister for the Environment and Energy. Will the minister update the House on the government's response to the closure of Hazelwood Power Station at Morwell in Latrobe Valley? And what is the government doing to maintain energy security? And is the minister aware of any alternative approaches?
The Minister for the Environment and Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I thank the member for Macmillan for his question, recognising his deep commitment to the job security of those in his electorate. The decision by the owners of Hazelwood to close at the end of March next year is a sad day for the workers, a sad day for their families and a sad day for the community in the Latrobe Valley. Now, the Turnbull government stands ready to assist those workers by announcing a $43 million package, which will include job active assistance and training, which will also include an infrastructure component as well as a jobs and investment package, Mr. Speaker. The government will continue to work with the Australian Energy Regulator to ensure that the upward pressure on prices is not too great, as well as working with the Australian Energy Market Operator to ensure energy security and the stability of the grid is maintained, bearing in mind that Victoria will now go from being a net energy exporter to a net energy importer, as 22% of Victoria's supply is taken out of the equation. Now, I'm asked by the member for Macmillan, am I aware of any alternative approaches? Now, I'm at least aware of 12 different approaches from those opposite when it comes to energy policy over less than 10 decades. Let's go through it. The CPRS, in less than a decade. 12 different approaches in less than a decade.
Members
the
on
CPRS,
my left.
And you were for it, then you weren't. That Athenian model of democracy
the Citizens' Assembly. You were for that, then you weren't for that. Then you had that Jeffersonian quote, there will be no carbon tax under a government I lead, and then you went ahead and betrayed the Australian people by introducing the carbon tax. And then, of course, Mr. Speaker, you had a policy, a shameful policy, of giving more than $500 million of taxpayers' money to Hazelwood to keep it open to compensate it for the carbon tax. At the same time, the then member for Batman was negotiating with the owners of Hazelwood and other coal generators to actually close, Mr. Speaker. And now you have a policy of a 50% renewable energy target, where you're shamelessly trading away the blue-collar jobs in the regions for green votes in the city, Mr. Speaker. That is your policy, selling out blue-collar jobs in the region to win green votes in the city. Now, Mr. Speaker, you don't have to take my word for it of how bad Labor's policy. With the greatest respect to the Leader of Government Business, the real fixer was Graham Richardson. This is what he wrote in The Australian about Labor's policy. The farce of this policy has become obvious to all. Labor has no plan on how this target would be reached. Sadly, Labor is playing games with people's lives. It's no good playing roulette and hoping your numbers come up. The poor and the pensioners particularly require certainty about lights and heat, Mr. Speaker. Only the coalition can be trusted for energy security, energy affordability, and to get Australia to a lower emissions future.
The minister's time has concluded. The member for Hunter.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister for Agriculture. I again refer to his comments this morning and note that on March 2, 2015, the then Secretary of his department sent a letter to the Minister which stated, and I quote, "I am writing to advise you that I no longer have confidence in my capacity to resolve matters relating to integrity with you. This follows the sequence of events before and following the alterations to Hansard that were made on October 2014. Minister, apart from the alteration to Hansard, were there any other occasions on which the former secretary raised concerns either with you directly or with your office about your approach to
the members on my right? The Deputy Prime Minister has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, it is a special day when you get the quinella. It's a special day when you get to Cornella. And ultimately what's happened now is the member for Hunter, is obviously, he's gone into the tactics meeting, he's talked to the Leader of the Opposition, please give me a question, please, please, please. He's run it past the Leader of Opposition Business. I need a question. It's been a year. Give me a question. Come on, help me out, help me out. And then after he comes up with an absolute Barry Crocker for his first one, he comes back to the dispatch box for his next one. Well, it's great. It's great when they're bowling your molly grubbers. Now he's talking about an event from from well over a year and a half ago, which is well documented. Might I say, Mr. Speaker? Might I say, Mr. Speaker, that Dr. Paul Grimes himself called a Senate inquiry, which he went to himself and presented himself before that same Senate inquiry, where all the judicious approach of the inquisitive nature of the Senate were put at the disposal to ask the hard questions so as to get to the bottom of this dastardly event. And what did they come up with? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. And so about a year and a half later, because that's how long it takes him to get a question, up he bowls, the member for Hunter, to ask yet another absolute cracker of a question, to try and bring the government down single-handedly. Dr. Grimes would probably say, Dr. Grimes would say that it's not proper that you should come up with a policy that basically discriminates against Australian workers, especially when the leader of your party was a former AWU union rep, especially when a person was supposed to be looking after Australian workers, looking after farmers, looking after people on the land. But what have they come up with? They've come up with a policy that encourages you to employ people from overseas above Australian workers, and you just sit there smiling. Is that how you smiled when you did that to Clean Event? Is that how you smiled with your keto mushrooms? Is that the smirk you had in your face when you were letting down those workers? But now you've let down every member of the AWU who works on a farm.
The Deputy Prime Minister will resume his seat just for a second. Member for Solomon will leave under 94A. Just make clear to all members that when they refer to a member as you, they're referring to the Speaker. I don't particularly take offence, but I just want to point that out, and that's why it's important to report and to refer to members by their correct titles. The Deputy Prime Minister has the call.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I think that it's quite appropriate that the Australian people and the Australian ones who are watching this and not watching the US presidential election, for which I think we're about to see quite a startling result, understand that the Labor Party now stands for giving an advantage to overseas workers over Australian workers. That is a remarkable turn of events when economic policy is being devised by the Senator for Tasmania, Senator Jackie Lambie, and where you are going into a pact with the Australian Labor Party, One Nation and Senator Jackie Lambie. That is an interesting turn of events which I know the people who I used to share with would be very interested in. All those ticket holders will be very interested how the person on stand two is apparently taking home more per sheep than stand one.
The Minister's time has expired. That's right, that's right. The Minister's, the Deputy Prime Minister. Bye-bye. The Member for Hunter. Obviously, seeking to table a document.
Yeah. Yeah.
The member for Hunter seeking to table a
document. Don't go and leave, Malcolm.
Member for Hunter better proceed.
You are correct, Mr. Speaker. I seek leave to table the letter I referred to in the question from the now sacked departmental head, Dr. Grimes, to Minister Joyce, in which he calls into question the minister's integrity.
I won't. And I've made clear many times before that where a document is part of parliamentary papers or is freely publicly available, I won't even seek leave, and I'm very sure that's the case in this regard. The member for Latrobe.
My question is to the Minister for Infrastructure and Transport, representing the Minister for Regional Development. What steps is the government taking to support the Hazelwood Power Station workers and the Latrobe Valley?
The Minister for Infrastructure and Transport.
Hear, hear.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I'd like to thank the member for Latrobe for his interest in an issue which obviously has impacts right across Victoria. No doubt there will be some tough days ahead for the people of my community, with hundreds of direct job losses expected. It's a community I share with the member for McMillan. Latrobe Valley is a great community, as you are aware, Mr. Speaker. It's a diverse community and has a very rich and a proud history of providing the power for our nation, particularly in Victoria, in terms of underpinning the wealth of the state of Victoria. And the announcement that the Hazelwood Power Station will close at the end of March next year will create some very significant social and economic challenges for my community, for Gippsland Latrobe Valley region. And our thoughts are obviously with the workers, with their families, with the contractors and the small business owners who will be impacted as well. And I want to take the opportunity on behalf of Gippsland to thank the Prime Minister for the work he's done in relation to this issue. The moment that speculation arose, Mr. Speaker, there was a likelihood that Hazelwood may close. The Prime Minister formed a five-member cabinet task force to coordinate a federal response led by the Minister for Energy. And that meant, Mr. Speaker, that we could announce a $43 million package on day one of the announcement from the ENGIE, the owners of Hazelwood. It meant that we could send a message to the workers at Hazelwood, to the broader Gippsland Latrobe Valley community and to their families, that the community would not be left alone, in the sense that we'll be there to support them into the future. And the Minister for Regional Development joined me yesterday in Morwell, Mr. Speaker, to meet with Latrobe City Council representatives and community representatives, and we explained the immediate additional federal government assistance that would be provided, and I must say it was well received by the community. Our support will be focused on supporting and creating new jobs and also investing in the infrastructure that the region needs. The package includes a $3 million labour market structural adjustment package to help the employees impacted. It includes $20 million for the local infrastructure and $20 million for the regional jobs and investment package. And of course, Mr. Speaker, that comes on top of investments already made in the region that the Turnbull-Joyce government has been making in recent times. We've seen in the order of $210 million towards the Princes Highway duplication project, a project I acknowledge was first supported by the former Labor government, but also support for the $200 million for defence force expansion at the East Sale RAF base, around about $100 million in new infrastructure projects in this term of government, and also in the order of $65 million in new roads funding. Mr. Speaker, I said at the outset that the Latrobe Valley has a very rich and proud history of providing for the nation and for Victorians. But the region also has a great future, Mr. Speaker. We have a determined and resilient community. It's one which will obviously benefit from the investment package that I've discussed here today, but it will also benefit from its own hard work. The Turnbull-Joyce government stands ready to work with this community. It is a resilient community, it's a determined community, and we want to make sure we're there to help them prosper into the future.
The Prime Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I ask that further questions be placed on the notice paper.
I thank the Prime Minister. Just before members leave, I just want to refer to an earlier ruling I've made. As members are well aware, I have today, during question time, twice moved on from a question and an answer where members weren't referred to. Members didn't refer to other members by their proper parliamentary titles, as is required under the standing orders. And as I pointed out, I've flagged this in recent weeks in various debates, and particularly in question time. I just want the House to know I've done this with the purpose of reinforcing how important it is to the level of discourse in the House. And while I've taken action that's strong today, I will, of course, always consider the context in which the references are made to other members and have a practical attitude, but I do say adverse references to other members will be taken particularly seriously, and it's a warning to all members to refer to other members in the House. Obviously, I'll take a practical approach to it. Members know that, but for the two members concerned, it was strong action I've taken, I say, and timing was unlucky given the number of instances we've had of it. I just wanted to say that at the conclusion of question time. The member for Sydney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Pardon? Mr.